Welcome to Incognito, the podcast. I'm your host, Michael Fosberg, and today I'm flying solo. I'm going to call this episode, Nobody Wants to Talk About It, Race, Identity, and the Difficulties in Forging Meaningful Conversations, which is taken directly from the title of my recently published book, and which might appear to be a particularly interesting contradiction given where we stand today, or where we stood, perhaps. It seems since the murder of George Floyd and the subsequent international protests that now everybody wants to talk about race. Although, since said murder and conviction of the offending officer, and another murder of a black man in Georgia and the subsequent conviction of those perpetrators, there seems to have been a bit of a backlash, or swing, if you will. Whether it was the national response to those events, the protests that followed, perhaps fear of Black Lives Matter protests, or who knows what. We have watched various states pass laws banning the teaching of what has been labeled as CRT, or critical race theory. Aside from the obvious that critical race theory, CRT, is not being taught to grade school and high school students, and is primarily a graduate law school area of study, we are also seeing school districts limit the teaching of any divisive topics that deal with black history, which can make students, white students, feel uncomfortable. And in Florida in particular, a law has been passed which allows any student or parent, as well as any employee of a private company, to sue said school or company if they are subjected to diversity and inclusion training that makes them feel uncomfortable. I hesitate to say we've gone through the looking glass, Alice. And yet, we are still dealing with an added challenge that we are physically more distant in what has become our new coronavirus abnormal. More folks are still working virtually, remotely, or in some sort of hybrid situation. So the big challenge is how do we find ways to unite us, bring us closer together in such a fraught and sometimes distant environment? Kind of the point of this whole podcast. Today, I'm going to offer you a meaningful method to overcome these obstacles, which you've heard me mention before. It's called intergroup contact theory. Yeah, I know. That sounds very academic, right? Intergroup contact theory is a proven model. Its premise is that by sharing our personal stories across majority and minority populations, we can break down the prejudices that exist between us by discovering that we have a lot more in common than we have different. It's true. We have more in common than different. This theory, put simpler, storytelling. Whether together in a room or across cyberspace, by sharing our personal stories, we discover our commonalities and thus our shared human experience. Now, storytelling is not some new gimmick or complicated process. We all tell stories, whether we recognize it or not. Storytelling is the foundation of our lives and businesses. Stories are the news we read and ingest, the television and movies we watch, the advertisements, products, and services we consume, the phone calls we make, even the problems we solve. We are stories. I quite often hear people tell me, after they've heard my story, that their own personal story is boring or uninteresting. I can tell you that is entirely untrue. We all have rich and complicated personal stories. The issue is whether we are actually sharing them, to whom, how we are going about telling our story, and here's the catch, whether we are recognizing the common bonds and experiences we share. As many of you know, for the past 15 years or more, I've been traveling around the country to high schools and colleges, corporations and government agencies, law firms, as well as not-for-profits, telling my personal story in the form of a one-man play. By this point, you should already know my story, but if not, go back and listen to episode number one of this podcast. Anyway, my story exposes a family secret, one kept hush for a long time while growing up in a white working-class family. But really, what family doesn't have a secret? So I've had the good fortune to have traveled around the country for the past 15 plus years, sharing my own personal story in an effort to facilitate dialogue about issues of race and identity. By using the idea of storytelling through the means of the arts of one-man play, I've been able to create dialogues with people about the uncomfortable topics of race, identity, diversity, stereotypes, and inclusion. And along this journey, I have discovered tools, 7 to be exact, that can help lead to more authentic and meaningful conversations around these topics. Thus, the focus of today's podcast, the tools. Now, some of these were things I had heard that made sense in a particular situation I found myself. Some revealed themselves in the actual moments I was struggling to facilitate constructive dialogues with people while on the road touring my show, and some simply just seemed obvious based on all the relevant information at hand. So let's break these down. The first tool might be the most obvious here, but that is to tell your story. Open up and listen. By sharing our personal stories, we discover commonalities. Look, if we are going to engage in a conversation about race and identity, we need to put our experience on the table first thing so we know who's in the room and the depth of our experience. The concept of identity is complex. It's shaped by individual characteristics, family dynamics, historical factors, and social and political contexts. Who am I? Do I identify with a group, a school, sports, a company, a religion, ethnicity, a race, gender, an age, disability, and on and on? We all arrive at our identities in different ways. Even in an immediate family, a mother, father, son, and daughter, each will come to their own specific, unique identity in their own way. Sure, they may all share some things, traits, cultural aspects, but each will see themselves differently. One may be more attracted to sports, another the arts. One may find their bliss in cooking, and yet another may strongly identify as a writer. This holds true for every family, each person. We all have our own unique journey with identity. And it is important to recognize that identity is fluid. It is constantly changing. Look, there are obviously some things about us that do not change. Our skin color, our nationality, our gender, perhaps. However, the ways in which we identify may shift over our lives. Many changes happen over the course of our lives, which revise the way we see ourselves. Look, we graduate it when we see ourselves as a college graduate. We get married and we see ourselves as a husband or a wife or perhaps partner. We have kids and now we are parents. Our kids have kids and we see ourselves as grandparents. These are simple yet significant changes that happen over the course of our lives, which alter the ways in which we may identify. It is, however, interesting that the way we see ourselves is rarely the way others see us. And yet, it's my identity, not yours. I'd like to share a quote from the great Black American writer James Baldwin. He wrote, "You cannot define me. I define myself. I cannot let anyone define who I am, whether I'm gay, whether I'm black, whether I'm a writer, whether I'm this or that. This is my own responsibility to define myself. And I am not a finished product. I am always in construction because I learn, I have experience, and I see the world." The next tool is don't judge the differences. Flip the script. Instead of allowing the differences to create a wall between us, start by finding a mutual interest and then embrace the differences. After all, if we were all the same, we'd be bored. It's the differences that make us stand out as people, and it's the differences that make us unique in the marketplace. We generally judge people from a first impression. We allow skin color, accents, different languages, differing sexual orientations, ideologies, religions, and more to separate us. Quite often, it is the first things we see that play an oversized role in the way we judge. It has been said that you only get one chance to make a first impression. These first impressions or judgments are sometimes referred to as unconscious biases. Prejudices we have and are unaware of that distort the way we see people. Look, if you suddenly find yourself judging based on difference, stop and ask a question. Why am I allowing someone's difference to create a wall between us? Look, I was once set to give a keynote address at a conference for a very large multinational corporation, which hosted an annual two-day diversity conference for close to 1,000 employees each year. The conference opened with the chief diversity officer giving a summation of where the company stood in terms of its diversity initiatives. Then their CEO addressed the ballroom full of employees from all over the world, laying out their vision for the future. Following that, the CEO offered attendees a chance to ask him questions. Now, throughout the vast hall, volunteers with microphones would seek out employees when they raised their hand so they could ask their question. However, the CEO requested two things of those who desired to pose a question. He asked them to state their name and plant where they worked, along with two personal hobbies they enjoyed. A simple and, if I might say, brilliant request. With this request, he was opening a door on making a connection, a simple, fun, and yet often quite revealing probe in order to make a connection. What kind of hobbies do you have? What do you like to do outside of work? What interests do you have outside of work? In these simple questions, you can almost instantly find commonalities. Even if you don't share the same interests or hobbies, you may know someone who does. Or you may learn something fascinating about a person that would provoke you to ask more questions. Perhaps the person is a sports fan of a particular team. That's a common and universal connection for many. Or what if, and this is a little bit more obscure, someone's hobby is beekeeping? Look, I don't know about you, but I want to know more about that. That simple request from the company's CEO that day allowed him to find and make a connection with an employee, discovering a commonality or perhaps even a unique difference allowed them both to relax. Even if neither of them had the same hobbies, it allowed them to connect in some way that could lead to commonalities. And again, commonalities build bridges. I have another favorite quote from a book titled The Knicks by Nathan Hill. He wrote, "If you see people as enemies or obstacles or traps, you will be at constant war with them and with yourself. Whereas if you choose to see people as puzzles and see yourself as a puzzle, then you will be constantly delighted because eventually, if you dig deep enough into anybody, if you really look under the hood of someone's life, you will find something familiar." Next up is tool number three. We must recognize there isn't any one way to have a conversation about identity and race. We all have different experiences and therefore bring different points of view to the table. This is actually the strength of our collective spirit, our diversity. Look, there are many different methods used to try and help people understand race, identity, privilege, racism, bias, microaggressions, and other difficult topics. Some work more successfully than others, but not all work for all people. Some of you may walk away from this podcast thinking deeply about what I've shared. Perhaps it'll spur other deeper conversations with colleagues, family, and friends. And some of you will walk away, if you haven't already pressed stop, thinking, damn, I can't get that time back. We're not all going to agree on what is the best method to discuss these issues because, again, there isn't just one way to do it. We don't all read the same book and walk away with the same message. Tool number four. We can disagree so long as we're not disagreeable. We must take responsibility for the language we use. Freedom of speech carries responsibilities. It is important to point out we all cherish our constitutionally guaranteed right to freedom of speech, but with that comes responsibility. Just as the cliché suggests there is no free lunch, so too there is no free speech. What you say, the language you use, has an effect of which most of us never consider. There is not a person listening to this podcast who has not been affected negatively by something someone has said to you. For some of us, we carry that hurt our entire lives. Others spend years in therapy, and for some, they just brush it aside, unaware of the psychic damage that lies beneath the surface. Some of us have been called names or spoken to in a derogatory way. Perhaps we've been on the receiving end of some very harsh language. Do you use that kind of language, and why? Do you realize the effect of that kind of language on the person it is directed to? Words are like weapons, and we need to take care with how we use them. Recognize this and take responsibility for the language you choose to use. Look, studies have proven that anger spreads faster online than joy, sadness, or even disgust. Venting, contrary to what we've been told, makes us more likely to become aggressive rather than serve as a therapeutic remedy. Emotions are real things. Anger is a physiological reaction in the body. It is as unreal as the online world may seem. Emotions can travel through it. Tool number 5, get comfortable being uncomfortable. And once people begin talking about their respective experiences, it may start to get uncomfortable. I know the idea of getting comfortable being uncomfortable sounds a little crazy, but we actually do something like this probably every day. Think about your day. There's probably something that happens over the course of an average day during which you feel uncomfortable. Whether we recognize this or not, we all experience something, some moment where we find we must work through an uncomfortable situation, whether it's with your kids, a spouse, an employee, our boss, or God forbid, some authority figure. We all work through uncomfortable situations each day, and we're able to get through them. We can do the same with the conversation about race and identity. Rather, we must do the same. Tool number 6, understand there are realities outside your own experience. Just because we may not have experienced racism, sexism, homophobia, age discrimination, disability indifference, or other forms of discriminatory treatment doesn't mean those are not realities for other people. Listen with empathy. Look, there's one thing that I think all of us here in the U.S. of A. share, and that is we are all Americans. Now, I want to ask a simple question in relationship to this. What does it mean to be an American? Now, if you ask this question to a dozen different people, you would most likely get a dozen different answers. It means something different to each of us, and yet we all share the title. That is what makes us all Americans, that we are different and yet all the same. But we assume that as Americans, we all share the same experience. How can we all share the same American experience if we all see being American as slightly different? Open up, share, and listen. And finally, tool number 7, practice forgiveness. It has been described as the hardest work you will ever do, but the most rewarding. So how does one do this? It is important to note that you can forgive someone yet not condone their actions. It may be difficult to reconcile this, but just because we forgive someone does not mean we also condone their behavior. However, holding on to resentment is, in essence, holding on to anger, and it keeps us from moving on. It holds us in that spot continually. Here's one thing I've heard repeated over and over again. There couldn't be a better time for inclusion. In this environment, in the circumstances we find ourselves, I ask why. What makes inclusion more important now? Well, I'd suggest it's pretty obvious. No matter what side of the political ideological side you may fall, you have to admit we are not all on the same page. To put it more bluntly, we are not united. Thus, our response and approach has been scattered at best. We push away those who do not think like us, do not share the same beliefs, in some cases look and sound differently than us. And why? Because we have determined they are not us. That word, us, U.S., United States. Yeah, this may sound corny or schmaltzy or, I don't know, too on the nose, but with this in mind, what do you think we could accomplish if we could become more united? And how would we get there? As I said and contend, we can get there by finding our commonalities. We all share commonalities. Commonalities bond us, help establish trust, and more importantly, can create an inclusive space in which we all feel a sense of belonging. And we must embrace the differences. Again, it's the differences that make us stand out as people, and from a business standpoint, it's the differences that make us unique in the marketplace. I'd like to leave you with a story that cements this idea of the importance of finding commonalities. And this story is the opening story in my new book. It took place in early spring of 2019 when I found myself standing in a rather large, beautiful room at a significant federal agency in Washington, D.C., which will remain unnamed at this point. I was there to perform my one-man play for a group of federal employees. It was in an extraordinarily ornate historic space, and I'd been invited there by the Director of Diversity and Inclusion for this agency, with whom I'd had a long-standing business relationship with over the past several years. They'd set up a makeshift stage with drapery as a backdrop and chairs all fanned out in sort of a semicircle facing the stage area. And like many government agencies, there's a great deal of pomp and circumstance surrounding visits by speakers and presenters, and mine was no exception. I was brought into another elaborately decorated and equally historic room to participate in the obligatory photo op with a senior administrator from the agency who was going to introduce my program and then whisk away to their office to continue the work that they were doing. And I'd been warned earlier by my host that this particular administrator was not a big fan of her work. He had pushed back on the importance of diversity and saw efforts to create a workplace of inclusion as divisive at best. So when I met him, I was determined to win him over, utilizing the lessons I'd learned over the years of traveling, performing, and meeting people with doubts like his. I mean, I would find out who he is, what his story is, and search for our commonalities. So he entered the room. We did the obligatory smiling, handshaking as we discussed my visit and unusual approach to diversity. He spoke about his life in the private sector and how he'd spent time out on the West Coast in Santa Monica, a connection we made almost immediately. And he talked with great enthusiasm about a commitment to making a difference in government. I expressed my admiration toward his sentiments about using his position to make a difference and pointed out our common goal, mine through the use of my play, that is my life story. And he became rather animated and exuberant during our conversation, and I could feel a genuine connection being forged. So when it came time for my presentation, he sort of blurted out he decided that he was going to stay, sit in the back of the room, perhaps give some closing remarks instead. So I was taken aback, as was my host, because it had been my experience, having done presentations in numerous federal agencies, that head administrators rarely have time to stay and watch these types of programs, especially a one-man play. These are busy people. They have a lot on their plates. So with that, my host, diversity director, gave a brief introduction, and I started the show. It was an audience of rapt federal employees. We had a great time. And when I finished, I was overwhelmed, as I often am, by the group as they rose in applause, including the administrator, who was still sitting in the back. He stood in unison with the audience on my bow, and their enthusiasm carried over into the post-show dialogue, which eventually led to the administrator rising in his chair and approaching the stage to offer his closing remarks. He had this huge smile plastered across his face, and he thanked me profusely, imploring the audience to reciprocate. And he continued by saying what a remarkable thing they'd all just experienced, one not soon to be forgotten, and how it might not be hyperbole to call this particular story a life-changing event for everyone. I was shaking my head at this point. I could tell he was deeply moved and shaken by the story and the resulting dialogue. He was struggling to put into words these strong emotions that he felt. And then he held up his phone to me, which he had in his hand, and he said, "You know, there's another remarkable similarity we share." He said, "I too had hair like yours when I was young. I guess you would call it, and he sort of stumbled as to how to describe what it was, unsure if it was proper for him to utter the term most often used to describe wild and curly Jewish hair. I looked at the faded photo of him on his phone, and I blurted out, "You had a Jew fro." And we were laughing, and I reached out and I offered him a soul handshake, which he enthusiastically returned. The audience lost it. And the moment was sealed. We had connected on a deep level. And it was my personal story that took him along his own ride with identity. But the story's not over here. So several days later, I was informed by my host that during a senior level staff meeting, the day following my presentation, this administrator stood up in front of the entire room full of leaders and praised my program, the one in which he rediscovered his Jew-fro from the past and the commonalities he shared with a guy, me, who looked just like him, but didn't actually have a Jew-fro, but something else entirely. So, this is our 10th episode, and I am so grateful for the assistance of Farah Sklar, my assistant and co-producer. Also, a big thanks go out to Ned Doheny for allowing me the use of the intro to his song, "Get It Up for Love," from his album, Hard Candy. You can check him out on Apple Music, Spotify, and other music streaming sources. And thanks to all of you for listening. Before I go, here's the big ask. I need your help, and there are several different ways in which you can do so. The first way is to buy a book. My memoir, Incognito, An American Odyssey of Race and Self-Discovery, published in 2011, along with the second book of which this particular episode of the podcast shares its title, Nobody Wants to Talk About It, Race, Identity, and the Difficulties in Forging Meaningful Conversations, published mid-2020. They can both be purchased either at the website incognitotheplay.com or on Amazon. However, if you purchase at the website, you'll receive an autographed copy if that makes it more enticing for you. Plus, we receive all the profits at the website, whereas at Amazon we have to share a little. Secondly, I implore you to share the podcast with 5 friends. I was going to say 10, but 5 is a reasonably easier task, which, by the way, you can ask those 5 people to pass it along to 5 of their friends. If you enjoy what you are hearing, and I'm assuming you are since you are here 10 episodes in, please let others know about this content. I don't use social media, and I can't really afford to advertise, so the growth of the podcast is incumbent upon your willingness to let others know about it. I'm not the begging type, but I'm begging. Bring me five. Third, if you have a business or work for a business that might like to provide sponsorship for an up-and-coming podcast like this, please let us know. We'd be happy to discuss a sponsorship deal with any and all who find value in my work. And finally, if you might know someone who you think would make a great guest on the show, let us know. I'm trying to reach out far and wide to a variety of people, fields, businesses, and disciplines, and am always looking for interesting people to speak with regarding the methods they use to bring people together and work more inclusively. I can honestly say that I have been thrilled and delighted by the conversation so far and the enormously helpful ideas, practices, and methods folks have shared. I welcome your thoughts and suggestions. So, there are four ways in which you can help. Choose one or all four. Get involved. Your help and support is most appreciated. A lot of this information will be in the show notes, so you can find it there. And I'll be back sometime after Labor Day with more episodes of Incognito, the podcast.